excited to be presenting Vidora today and talking a little bit about automated machine learning and some of the technology underlying that. Before I jump into the technical aspects of automated machine learning and how we accomplish that, I want to give a little background around the problem we're trying to solve as a company. So the general problem that Vidora is looking to solve is to enable machine learning technology for everyone in an organization, from marketers to product managers to data scientists to C-level execs. Machine learning is transforming what businesses are able to do with data, and we want to put machine learning in the hands of everyone in an organization. And so what we're really focused on is how we can enable the automation technology to put machine learning in the hands of everyone. And really what we're gonna focus on here, there's a lot of steps associated with machine learning. There's a lot more to it than just running a deep learner, than running a decision tree model. There's these pre-processing steps that are actually much more important than the actual machine learning model. And when we talk about the notion of automated machine learning, we're talking about the notion of how do we automate all the steps of machine learning, from when data comes in all the way to how people leverage the results of machine learning. And that's really the technology aspect. Just a bit, really briefly about the company. We're based in SoMa, in San Francisco. I'm in the middle there on the left. I did my undergrad at Cornell, did a PhD in machine learning and computer vision at Caltech. My co-founder, Abik, was an undergrad at IIT and did his PhD at Berkeley. Phil went to Stanford in computer science. And we tend to work with very large global enterprise organizations. These include folks like News Corp, Yahoo Japan, Walmart. And we've seen very strong growth the last few years. Just a couple of quotes around some of the people that are leveraging this automated machine learning technology, including Wall Street Journal. And you can see in general, the organizations work with are seeing very strong results. Okay, so let's get more into the meat of the presentation today. Really divided into four different parts. The first part is focused on the business challenges with machine learning today. So we're gonna dive a little bit more into what's making it difficult for organizations to leverage machine learning technology today. Second part, we're gonna focus on the notion of automated machine learning that's associated with Vidora's platform. The third part is what we call the product challenge. So it's one thing to have a great technology, it's another thing to really give this technology to everyone in the organization. So how do we make machine learning easy for everyone to use at an organization? And then the fourth part, for those of you who are interested in infrastructure and how we actually built out parts two and three, that's really where we'll focus on the underlying technology and infrastructure associated with our platform. So part one, business challenges with machine learning today. So typically when we work with a business, they're in one of these four states. So typically a business will start, especially the enterprise businesses we work with, will start by consolidating their data, putting their data in one place. And this is the data and analytics portion. So this has been happening for the last 10, 15 years now, where organizations have started to consolidate their data. And most organizations are in some place in their journey of actually consolidating their data. And there's a bunch of amazing large companies, including folks like Amazon and Google, who have great technologies in this area. Once the data is actually consolidated, typically organizations start focusing on, okay, let's try to do something with that data. And that's really where predictive modeling typically first rears its head. And the idea of predictive modeling is, can you use this data to make predictions? If you are a B2C subscription company, can you predict who's most likely to churn from your service? Once the business starts getting comfortable with the predictions, typically they begin implementing automation. And the idea with automation is not only to make predictions, but to let the machine learning algorithm control something autonomously. So no longer having really a human in the loop for some task, so automating some tasks. And typically what happens is there's a prediction made, there's a feedback loop, so data comes back, and then the prediction gets better. And so you have these closed feedback loops where the automated system gets better and better and better. Where we're focused is this notion of strategic AI, which we think is this next phase where we take machine learning and AI out of the hands of just data scientists, machine learning engineers, and really enable it for the entire business. So if you look at it from the standpoint of who has access to which parts of this kind of evolution of machine learning, on the left-hand side, there's a lot of amazing platforms to visualize data that the entire organization uses today. Some of the more common ones are Tableau, Looker's a more recent company in the space, but there's literally hundreds of companies in that space that focused on more the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, typically to implement everything from predictive modeling to automation, typically you have specialist data scientists and machine learning engineers that are really focused on that area. And so as we look at the challenges as a company, and this really leads into the next two sections, we look at a technology challenge, which is how do we automate machine learning? And two, how do we then make that product, make machine learning available to the entire organization? So automating machine learning, this is really the technology challenge. So how do we automate the tasks typically associated with machine learning? And to start, it's kind of useful to look at what are the tasks that are associated with machine learning. So as I mentioned earlier, machine learning is a ton more than just figuring out what sort of machine learning model to use, which is really the right-hand side, which is model selection, which I would actually argue is the easiest of these three tasks. So typically when you have data sitting in maybe a Redshift or some sort of data warehouse or data lake, the first thing one needs to do is clean that data. So this involves tactics like cleaning out outliers, dealing with missing data, consolidating data. So typically feature cleaning is the first task, and typically data scientists spend a ton of time on this first task. But you're not done yet. So the next task is typically called feature engineering. And the idea is the raw features that are used as the raw features you have sitting in your data lake are often not the right features to feed into a machine learning model. So typically that next phase involves transforming those features in some way. An easy example, again, sticking with the example of predicting who's most likely to churn from your B2C subscription service, is if you look at a user's activity, the absolute value of their activity. So if they come once a day for a period of a year, that is usually less insightful than changes in activity. So if someone comes once a day for the last year, but all of a sudden they start coming once a week, then once a month, clearly that derivative or that change in activity is much more indicative of, in this case, churn, than the absolute value of that activity. And so you can think there's actually an infinite number of ways to transform those raw features. And that's the space of feature engineering. And to date, again, that falls in the realm of data scientists. And this includes techniques like dimensionality reduction, PCA being a common form of that, et cetera. And there's really an infinite number of ways to transform those raw features into features actually fed into the model. And then the last piece is typically what engineers, machine learning engineers like to do the most, which is play with the actual learners. And there are literally hundreds, thousands of different types of machine learning models, ranging from neural networks to decision trees to Bayesian networks to boosting, support vector machines, you name it. And within those groups, there's tons of permutations. So the typical examples of neural network, how do you choose how many layers and how many units in each layer to use? These are the hyperparameters of the model. And so you have these three steps. These three steps are really what one needs to do in order to implement a machine learning algorithm. And typically, it's difficult. So these steps are difficult. Data scientists and machine learning engineers are spending a lot of time on these three steps. And really what we're looking to do is, can we help data scientists, can we help the rest of the organization get access to machine learning, actually automating some of these steps for subsets of problems that are interesting for a business? And that's what the notion of automated machine learning, when we talk about automated machine learning or AutoML, we talk about how do we automate these three steps. And that's one of the core technology challenges that we're tackling at Vidora today. To look at it in a slightly different angle, if you look at this box in the middle, those are the steps that are involved in machine learning. So typically, if you start on the left-hand side here, you have real-time behavioral data, you have user data, you have typically goals that you set. And then what happens in this box, there's a whole morass of areas that the data scientists and machine learning engineers focus on: data ingestion, data engineering, model selection from potentially thousands of different models. It's well known that it's unclear which particular machine learning model is going to perform best a priori on a data set. So you gotta try them all. You gotta try multiple different ones. And then on the far right-hand side is enabling this technology for an organization. So for instance, if you are updating a site in real time, so let's take the example of a content, using machine learning for a content recommendation, and you are a site, like, let's say, Wall Street Journal, which gets millions of visitors a day, you need to have real-time infrastructure that's capable of serving up those recommendations, right? And so there's this aspect on the far right-hand side of not only do you have to figure out how to clean the data, feature engineer, select the right model, but then you have to expose that information at scale, especially when it's live in a product. And that's another big piece. And really what we do at Vidora is we say, look, for subsets of problems, we can actually automate that using automated machine learning. And so we have a few products and ways to expose that information and this automation to the organization via products we call Cortex Queries, Cortex Connectors, and Cortex Insights. Cortex Queries lets you basically run machine learning model and kind of ask questions to those models. Cortex Connectors lets you kind of connect with those models with real-time APIs. And then Cortex Insights lets you actually measure performance and get insights into which features are winning, et cetera. But really, this is what this box in here is: automated machine learning. Cortex is an automated machine learning system that takes you from this, so all these tasks, to this, making it very easy to leverage machine learning technology. And the better we get at the automated machine learning algorithms, the better we get at exposing this information. That's going to result in more and more people and organizations having access to transformative machine learning technology and algorithms. So let's talk a little bit about the product challenge, and then of course I'm going to dive into the actual infrastructure and how we really enable all this technology. So again, the product challenge is, great, so we've done automated machine learning. Now, how do we make machine learning accessible to anyone in an organization, non-technical folks in particular, folks like marketers and product managers that may not have extensive technical training? And really the goals, when you think about the goals of the product, are one, simplicity. So if we're really aiming to have C-level execs leverage machine learning, they don't have a lot of time to dive into data and deal with a lot of complexity. You have to make it simple to use. The second is flexibility. So organizations have a lot of different types of questions that can be answered using machine learning. They have a lot of different types of automation that can be enabled using machine learning. And so making the system flexible to what a particular organization needs is a key component. Now, as most developers and product managers know, simplicity and flexibility tend to be a little bit antithetical. So what I mean is, as you have a more flexible system, typically it gets less simple. And as you have a more simple system, typically the expressive power and the sophistication of what you can do decreases. So these are tough ones to weigh against one another. But I'll show you how we tackle it at Vidora and challenges we try to surmount. And then the third is visibility. So typically when we work with organizations, it's really important to make sure that we kind of show our work. So we actually want to show what's happening inside the platform. So give you visibility into, let's say, which models are winning, which features are winning. And I'll show you that in a second as well. So here's some examples of how people use Cortex today, and then I'll show you how we enable that for them. But so examples of Cortex queries, things like find all the users that are 80% likely to churn, and the best video to send them to reduce churn. So going back to the example of churn, you might want to identify, you might want to create a predictive model that says, hey, who's most likely to churn? And hey, what video should I send them to prevent them from churn? On the far right, if you have that same subscription paywall, you might want to ask, hey, what should I price my paywall at in order to generate the most, the maximum profits, right? So you need to predict who's most likely to convert through a paywall in order to generate the most profits. This is actually a snapshot of the product and how folks can actually create queries and basically ask the system questions. Here's kind of how the system works in terms of looking at all the different features. And again, it's very valuable to actually show your work in terms of which features are winning. And so typically our partners can have anywhere from tens to hundreds to thousands to tens of thousands of features. And typically they also want visibility into, hey, what's most important? What's most predictive in terms of winning? And so as we run through the different models, there's a notion of which features are actually most predictive. And then obviously, as we discussed earlier, which models are winning is also a very important aspect. So the idea is that depending on which model is used, it's going to have higher or lesser performance on a particular data set, but it's not known which model is going to win a priori. So a big piece of what the platform needs to figure out is, hey, how do you actually figure out which models are winning? I'm going to skip through the demo just because it looks like we're actually almost running short on time, and I want to make sure we actually have time to go through some of the underlying technology and infrastructure. So now I want to talk a little bit about how we enable this automated machine learning, and in particular, how we enable the product you saw, which we call Cortex. And there's really three key components. One is reliable uptime and scalability. So we work with partners like News Corp, where we work with dozens of their sites, ranging from folks like Realtor.com to HarperCollins to Wall Street Journal. They have dozens and dozens of sites. So how do we make sure that we're able to deal with that kind of scale? Cortex will deal with that kind of scale. The second is many of our partners want real-time automation. So as we discussed earlier, we need infrastructure that's able to handle kind of real-time requests, real-time kind of updates and requests at scale. And then finally, we want to make it easy for customers to add additional data, add additional business goals, et cetera. So I thought it would be useful actually to kind of walk through the evolution of our technology stack. So kind of where we started from to where we ended up. And on the left-hand side, you see kind of the early days. So when we first got started, some of the technology stack we leveraged, and I will kind of give a plug to AWS since we've been using them from day one, and they've actually been great partners for us. But we run almost all of our technology on Amazon Web Services. So if you look at the left-hand side, you see kind of some of the basic services that we started out with. And then if you look on the right-hand side, you see kind of how we've evolved into using more complex services. So as we've scaled our business, AWS has really helped us scale in terms of the technology that we leverage. We make heavy use of spot fleets, EMR clusters, et cetera. And we continue to evolve kind of the underlying architecture. This is more or less what, this is kind of a rough cut kind of what our AWS infrastructure looks like. And this is really what enables this notion of automated machine learning, which is automating these steps of feature cleaning, feature engineering, and then model selection. So if you kind of start on the left hand side, you see typically we have customer data. This can be real time data. So we take a lot of data from users' interactions in the UI. Then we leverage EC2 heavily and data frames heavily to actually store a lot of that process data. Ultimately, if you go to the far right-hand side, we actually have API servers that we stand up, also in EC2. These are global. We work with companies in Japan, in Australia, in the UK. So we're really leveraging the global footprint of AWS in order to serve nearly real-time machine learning infrastructure. But you know, I won't get into all the details here because I'm going to point you at a few pieces of collateral that are on our website just around that go into a lot more detail around how we've implemented this. We actually did a video with Amazon which walks through this, and we also have a blog post which we did with Amazon which kind of walks through how we actually designed this infrastructure with my two co-founders, Phil and Abik. And here are kind of the links you can actually go to learn more. So there's a video. The AWS is actually at our office, and there's a video that talks through kind of tying together the product with the underlying infrastructure with Phil and Abik. You see them in the picture up there. And there's also an article that we wrote that also dives much more deeply into, in particular, how we've designed this to be a global infrastructure to really enable real-time machine learning globally, which again is important given our global footprint as a business. So I know we only had 20 minutes today, so I'll kind of end by talking about, you know, where we're looking to focus next, what kind of our next area focuses are, especially from the technology standpoint. So one of the areas of foci for us is the notion of, so we talked about all the features that are generated, the super features that are generated, talked about all the models that are generated. That space is starting to explode for us. So you can think about every time we add a new model, that in theory doubles the number of permutations we have to search through and in order to find the optimal performing automated machine learning pipeline. So smart ways to search through that space is an area that we'll start exploring next year. So how do we intelligently search through the space of engineered features? How do we intelligently search through the space of models in a way that's less computationally intensive? Right now, it can take a long time, one, to kind of search all the models. It's also costly for us to search through all those permutations, especially when we deal with large data sets. So that's an area that we have started to think about, and it's an area actually of active exploration in the broader machine learning space at this year's ICML conference, which is, in my opinion, the premier conference for machine learning. They actually had a panel and a breakout session that looked specifically at ideas in this area about using Bayesian techniques to actually cleverly search through that space rather than exhaustively. And then the other area that we're really focused on from a product perspective is how do we increase the sophistication of goals that we can set within Cortex as we increase who's using Cortex. So to executives, the goals that they set get more complicated. So for instance, if you are the general manager of Wall Street Journal, you don't simply want to reduce churn, even though it's a subscription product. You might want to put a weight on that and say, each churning user costs me this much, but each user I'm able to upsell to another product like Wall Street Journal Plus, or each user I can get to go to 10 extra pages, given that they also have an ad-based form of their revenue, is worth X amount. So you can really see more complex goals that can be set is going to be in a critical part of what we do in the future, and really how we make sure that tons and tons of folks are actually leveraging this technology. And then, you know, I'll just point you to our website. So again, my name is Alex. I'm one of the founders and CEO of Vidora. We have a ton more collateral just around the underlying architecture and system architecture that Abik, my co-founder and CTO, and Phil, the head of product here, have created. Really want to give back to the community around how we actually enable this. And then, you know, just a quick plug: we are hiring in the engineering side. So we're looking for folks to focus more on the product side, which is this generalist engineering, as well as the machine learning side, which is really building out this AutoML pipeline. So with that, I know we're at 25 minutes, so I'll end, but it was a pleasure having the opportunity to present to everyone. Thank you. Bye.